Now, as students of public administration, there is no need to explain to you what is the meaning or the definition or the scope of public administration. Just a few words and then we will go on to CPA. By CPA, I mean comparative public administration. Now, public administration, as you know, is an offshoot of political science and it studies the administrative activities of public bodies, public officials, public entities and public institutions. And this subject is today, which was in its infancy not very long ago, has come into its own and it has developed into a full-fledged subject. Public administration, if it deals with the routine administration of political systems, comparative public administration is a study in comparison of several political systems. Now, the link between public administration and CPA is that CPA is one branch of public administration. It is a sub-field of public administration. It is a field of study where you compare and contrast. The comparison and the contrasting takes place between and among several political systems which are different in their socio-economic, political, economic and ecological and historical background. It is the comparison that helps us or enables us to understand the working of not one system but several systems together. We can analyze and scrutinize and find out what are the factors that lie behind the political system, the way in which it has developed and the shape or the manner it is functioning today. And public administration has made this study of CPA a separate branch in its own right. So, what does CPA stand for? It stands for the intensive and extensive study of many political systems which may differ, as I told you, in their historical background, ecological background and other social, economic and other factors. Now, these systems are those that have come into existence at different points of time. It is very valuable and significant to understand how one political system functions and what similarities and differences that it has with similar other or different other political systems. Now, that is the nub or the heart or the essence of our study. We compare and contrast different political systems, not taking them away from their milieu or background, but studying them as they have grown and developed and to see whether any uniformity or any kind of universalization can be approached by such kind of study. This is the content of CPA. Another factor is the significant item that is included in CPA is that, as I told you, alongside of one political system, other political systems also reveal their special characteristics, and we know that this will help us to a better understanding of comparative public administration. Now, formerly, the world was divided into the developed world and the developing world. Now, in the developed world, that is called the West, including USA and other European countries, we find that administration has moved very much far away from its birth or its roots and has now come to be a separate distinct subject having validity and value of its own. But if we turn to the other countries, the other bracket, these are called the Asian democracies or Asian countries or third world countries or the developing countries or the, you can say, the underdeveloped countries. Now, whatever title you give them, they are in a class of their own. You will need to know why we separate the two from one another. One reason is because all these countries, including India, Burma, and Sri Lanka, and many of other distant countries, have been under colonialism and imperialism for a long, long time. In India, for more than 1.5 centuries, the public institutions that were introduced and those that are still functioning, some of them, they are the legacy that the British have given to us. And therefore, we say that Indian administration begins as British administration and then has to find out a path of its own. Now, when we compare these systems, we find that now, for the time being, we will leave alone the developed West. Our concern is more with comparison of third world countries. And these countries are poor. These are their common features. They are poor. Poverty is a very big problem so far as they are concerned. Economically, they are weak because they do not have the sufficient raw materials or the industrial capability to develop themselves. And thirdly, they have huge populations to which they have to cater to their basic needs. Apart from all this, we find that their administrative systems are still in an undeveloped stage. They are, in a word, unstable and also near collapse. Now, some of them have been able to revive and develop and grow into full-fledged political systems. And this is where we start our study of comparative public administration by comparing these two sets of administrative entities and find out more why is it that these third world countries are unable to make themselves ahead of the developed West. This factor is important because CPA is, I should say in the beginning, an integral part of public administration, a significant element that contributes to the enrichment of the theory of public administration. CPA is one such field of study which broadens and enhances and widens the very literature and theorization in public administration. So we find that it has become a very important and significant part of the study of public administration. Now, when we take CPA by itself, one of the foremost factors that you have to note is that this kind of comparison and contrast helps us to understand these political systems on a wider surface, and also we can find out how their working is functioning, or their working is according to the West, or can we create a non-West model for these developing countries. So, the theory that is produced by CPA is important because it contributes to the building up of the literature and the theory of public administration. Then, the next fact that we have to note about comparative public administration is that the similarities and the differences that we note as we go along with our study is something that needs to be studied, because we find that the third world countries, which are immature and on the path of development, can learn from and copy from the developed West and adapt them to their own surroundings insofar as their economic, social and political cultures allow them to do so. Now, CPA is actually not a very new subject, even though it is now allied with public administration, the mother discipline. We find that it has been in existence for a very long time. Actually, it goes back to the days of the Greek philosophers, the twin philosophers Plato and Aristotle. You must have heard of them, I am sure. And Aristotle, as you know, is called the father of political science. Now, in his book The Politicus, he has described about the functioning of more than 100 constitutions that were then working in the different city-states of Greece. Now, Aristotle tried a comparison and came to the conclusion that no uniform standards could be laid, because in one city-state, or in most of the city-states, it was the monarchical rule that was there, that is kingship, and in other states there was republican type of rule. In his own Athens, we find that democratic experiments, as well as you can say republican institutions, also developed and were tried by the rulers in Athens. So we find that the comparison actually begun by Aristotle helps us further to understand these types of systems, or these type of administrative. Now, we have to go back to the heart of our subject, that is comparative public administration. Now, this study was continued even under the Roman statesmen and others like Cicero, and it was a very profitable study, because today we can turn back the pages of the textbooks and find out what different types, or which different types of government used to exist at that time. Democracy was there, republicanism was there, oligarchy, and again you can say a kind of monarchy, single monarchy, double monarchy, and all these systems were verified and laid down by that great master of political thought, that is Plato and Aristotle. Now, in CPA we find that this is the launching pad for our study. It begins from here because the foundations were already built, but the reason why it was not able to become a full-fledged subject on its own is because of the following reasons. we find that after the time of the Greeks and the Romans, we find that there has been a steady decline in comparative analysis. Now, this comparative analysis requires certain tools that enable the comparison to be carried on. For example, we need analysis and scrutiny and also a redefining of the objectives of the study. Now, this was done only very much later on, we find. It started in America. Some scholars even say that the original home of public administration was USA. However, in USA, in the 1880s, there was a profound urge for comparative study. Now, the initiation for this was given by President Woodrow Wilson. I hope the name is familiar to you. A little aside, it was President Woodrow Wilson who, after the First World War, even though America did not take part in the war, he was the architect of the League of Nations. And you would also know the 14 points that he laid down. Now, so far as administration is concerned, Wilson's contribution is that he wanted a comparative study of different political systems, beginning with America. This lead put forward by Wilson was taken up by his colleagues and other scholars in public administration. Now, I will mention one or two names, Dwight Waldo, and also we find there was Robert Dahl, there was Ferrell Heady, and these thinkers joined with Wilson in order to bring about a study of comparative public administration. Now, the aim was to bring about a dichotomy between politics and administration, and the second effort was to separate public administration and comparative public administration and take the third item, that is CPA, and study it in its inclusivity. So, when that was done, we find that there were many writers who came forward with ideas and with, you can say, many texts and many books on comparative public administration. Now, this lead taken by America actually was strengthened during 1900s, but through or after the First World War, 1914-1918, we find that there was a slight backsliding of CPA because there was less interest in developing a comparative analysis. Now, at that time, colonialism and imperialism were the ruling masters of the world. As you know, many of the present third world countries, as we call them, were under colonialism, and they had no freedom to form or to establish independent administrative bodies of their own. But after independence, we find that they were able to make and to establish their own independent structures. Now, then we find at that time, these countries had several other problems, as I told you, hunger, poverty, disease, and economically slow revival, and lack of raw materials and industries, and all these had to be strengthened in order to make their administrative system strong and viable. So, what happened after the Second World War, 1939 to 1945, and with the coming of the UNO and the importance of USA as one of the big powers, we find that comparative public administration also came into the limelight. Now the effort was to study not the already developed institutions and administrative setup in the West, but to focus on third world countries and the working of their administrative institutions. Now freedom had given to them the breadth and the sanction and the option to select the type of governmental administration that they wanted. Most of them chose democratic republics as in India, and much of it was a copy of the West. After independence, they got a constitution of their own, and in that constitution, what was built up was a democratic framework. Within that democratic framework, they got an elected government, and that elected government now put forward the schemes for progress and development in all areas.